simply come. Longing just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within.
Do you know that the music you're listening to is from Satan? This music is from the devil. I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, this music is literally from the devil, from Satan himself. I know you might be thinking, oh man, brother, man, this brother is crazy. Brother, you're crazy. You're thinking this in your heart that I'm crazy. You are listening to a song that was approved by Satan. This music has nothing to do with our Heavenly Father. Because what the Most High require is obedience. The Most High does not require your praise. Your praise is nonsense. Your money is useless. The Most High don't care about nothing else from you. The Most High only cares about obedience. Obedience. What was the problem between the Most High and Adam and Eve? They did not obey his law. What was the problem between the Most High and Saul? He did not obey his law. What was the problem between the Most High and David? He did not obey his law. What was always the problem between the Most High and Israelite? They break his law. It's all about obedience. It is not all about Jesus. Keep listening. This is music from the devil. This music is from Satan.
Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. How much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours. Every single breath, I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. Yeah. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you.
I'm telling you that it's not all about Jesus. It is not all about Jesus. This is why I said that some of you will not understand what I'm talking about. My brothers and sisters, it is not all about Jesus. It is all about the laws of God. It is all about the laws of God. God forbid, it is not all about Jesus. It's not. It is absolutely not all about Jesus. It's all about keeping the laws of God.
Hallelujah.
That is the truth. That's just the truth. You have to understand that this message has been manufactured by the Gentiles. My brothers and sisters, this thing was not preached in the first century. What was being preached was not all about Jesus in the first century. It's in your Bible. Look at your Bible. It's right there. Look at your Bible. Look at the argument that they had in Acts chapter 15. I mean, it's very clear. This is something that I have noticed. I kept quiet because what I'm sharing with you right now is very sensitive. I cannot share this with anybody anyhow. This is something I can only share with people who are spiritually matured. This message, what I'm sharing with you today, is for only those who are spiritually matured. Someone who is not spiritually matured is going to get upset. They will feel like I am antichrist. They will feel like I'm trying to lead them away from Christ. I told you, I believe in Christ. I believe that he existed. I believe that he was born by virgin. Yes, some people don't believe that. IUIC don't believe that. IUIC does not believe that Christ was born by a virgin. I believe that Mary was a virgin. I believe that Christ existed. I believe that God sent Christ to come and die. I believe all that. But at the same time, it doesn't mean that it's all about Jesus. How can it be all about Jesus when he himself was sent? Think about it. Are we crazy? Is something wrong with us? How can he be sent by somebody to come on a message and all of a sudden it becomes all about him instead of the person that sent him? That makes no sense. There are hundreds and hundreds of music today. Do you know that the devil, oh my goodness, that's why I want to share this with you, my brothers and sisters. Open your eyes. Open your eyes. Do not misunderstand what I'm telling you here. It is not all about Jesus. It is not all about Jesus. The idea, the message, the doctrine, the gospel, the fake gospel that is all about Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, believe in Jesus. Jesus, blood of Jesus. Jesus, grace, mercy. This is a demonic, satanic message from Satan. My brothers and sisters, it is all about one thing. One thing and one thing only. Let me see if you know what I'm talking about. This message about Jesus, 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 Jesus is designed to do one thing. It is designed to do one thing. Now, let me ask you. Let me see who knows. Let me see those who are spiritually awake. What I'm sharing with you right now is not for everybody. This is not for everybody. I told you in the beginning that some of you may not understand what I'm talking about. You might be shocked in what I'm telling you that it's not all about Jesus. You might feel surprised. I told you this is not for everybody. Now, let me ask you a question. I'm telling you that all these messages, all this music, this modern day doctrine, this Christian doctrine that says it's all about Jesus, 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 and people focus more on Jesus more than our Creator. They focus more on Jesus more than God. It's all about Jesus. Let me ask you a question. Do you know why this message was created? Does anybody know? Quick question, quick answer. Do you know the purpose of this doctrine? The purpose. Do you know why?
Distraction from the Heavenly Father.
Okay. One. Yeah. Who else?
To keep people in their end. Make them think that they're worshiping the Most High, but not really.
They think what?
To make them think that they are worshiping the Most High, or as the brother said, to keep them in the position they are in. That goes along with the doctrine they teach. In other words, I like to say that the enemy gives them distractions to keep them exactly where they are, whether it's a distraction about is about Jesus alone or Jesus at the center of it all or so forth, or whether it's a distraction with this so-called fear antichrist or anything else to go along with it.
Oh my goodness. Okay. Two. I want to make sure I give everybody a chance, because everybody might want to, some of you might want to answer. So I want to make sure I give everybody a chance. Number two, who else want to, number three, who else wants to go? Why is there so much focus on Jesus? That's my question. Why? This focus is fake. This is not biblical. It's not there.
Shalom.
Yeah, the teaching you read.
It's what?
I said the teaching your rebellion towards the Most High. That's why they focus so much on Jesus.
Okay. Who else?
They don't want you to serve the Most High. But they use Jesus in front of the Most High.
Okay. Thank you. That's number three. Number four, who else Shalom. Wants to go?
Shalom.
Yes, go ahead. Shalom.
Greetings. Shalom. I think that the reason that the attention is taken from the Most High is because truly that is where our strength lies, in understanding and worshiping the Most High and not putting anything or anybody above Him. And as long as we do that, we never truly are loving the true Creator, and we're not worshiping the true Creator.
Okay. Yes. Yep. Yep. Okay. Who else wants to go? Maybe one more person. Because this is not for everybody. This message is for people who are truly spiritually matured. If I hear this in the past, some years ago, I hear you talking about this, I'm going to tune out. I will stop listening to you. I'll be like, this brother is the Antichrist. He hates Christ. Because of the way I have been indoctrinated to believe that it's all about Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Now, you guys nailed it. You nailed it. It's all, somebody wants to say something before we continue? Because I have other stuff I'm going to show you.
Yes, brother.
Yeah, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I don't know. I might be wrong. What about Isaiah 14, 13 through 16? That prophecy on Isaiah. Isn't the same thing?
Okay,
can you open Isaiah 14 for me?
Isaiah 14? Okay, will go there. We will okay. Let's go to Isaiah. So I'm gonna leave this one. I'll come back to this. This thing I wanted to show you. Let's go straight to Isaiah. Isaiah 14. Isaiah 14. Okay. Okay, Isaiah 14. Okay. You want me to open Isaiah 14? I have it.
Yeah. Okay, it's 14, 13 through 16.
Okay. From 13 to 16?
Yes, yes.
Isaiah 14 from verse 13, for you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of Elohim, I will also sit on the mount of the congregation, on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. I will be like the Most High. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depth of the pit. Those who see you will gaze at you and consider you, saying, is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms? Okay. So, brother, I just read this one. I think you are asking, is this the reason why people focus on Jesus?
Yes, I think that's prophecy. Yeah, it's aligned with the modern day Jesus, this Christianity Jesus. I think maybe I'm standing on a point of correction here. If I might be wrong, maybe you can clarify this for us. Maybe it's linking this with the current topic that you are on.
Yeah, Jesus. Oh my goodness, I'm going to say this. Oh man, I pray that you guys will understand. Oh my goodness. I'm about to say something right now, but I'm worried. I'm worried about saying this. Some of you may not understand it. Jesus, 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 you hear today. It's basically devil. Oh my goodness. Oh man. This kind of thing is something I can discuss with certain people, and I will not be worried. I'm worried that some of you might not understand what I'm talking about. This whole thing about Jesus, Jesus is the devil. The reason why, you know, I'm telling you the truth. How come our ancestors who were in the first century, how come they didn't focus on this? How come? How come Christ himself did not make himself to stand out? Christ was teaching in the temple. He was teaching in the temple every day. How come he did not go and start a new church somewhere else? This right here is talking about Lucifer. It's talking about the devil in Isaiah chapter 14. Yes, in a way, it has something to do with what we're discussing right now. In a way, it has. Absolutely, my brother. It does. Listen to this. I want to share something with you. Listen to this. I think this is the one. Let me see if this is the one.
Take it away from me, Jesus, take it away from me. Take it away from me, oh, daddy, take it away from me. Anything that will make me not to serve you. Take it away from me, anything that will make me not to honor you. Take it away from me, man.
Take it away from me, Jesus, take it away from me.
Alpha and Omega.
Take it away from me, Jesus, take it away from me.
Oh, my anything Jesus.
That will make me not to serve you. Take it away from me, anything.
Now, let me tell you something. You see this woman you see on this picture? That's our sister. Her music came out some years ago, maybe like 10 years ago or so. She's a good sister, right? But this song is one of the hundreds, if not thousands, of songs that our people have made. And it's all about Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. We have been deceived. My brothers and sisters, we have been deceived. It is not all about Jesus. It is not. It's a big distraction. That was why I asked you guys that question. I asked you, do you know why this has been created? It's to distract us from the only thing that matters. My brothers and sisters, the only thing that matters is obedience to the law. Obedience to the law. That is the only thing that matters. Obedience to the laws and the commandment. Nothing else matters. I give you a simple example. Look at the Garden of Eden. Ask yourself, what was the problem? The only thing that was a problem was disobedience. That's it. Look at all the people that the Most High God has problem with. It's always disobedient. But the devil have used the Gentiles to create a whole new gospel, a whole new doctrine. Oh my goodness, this is not good. This is not good. This is not good. This is blasphemy. This is not a good thing. I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, it is not a good thing. Deuteronomy 6. Deuteronomy 6 says something. I think it's Deuteronomy 6:4. It says something. The beginning says, love the Lord your God. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you, to observe in the land you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you and your children and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Are we having long life today? No. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey. Oh my goodness. That's the problem, my brothers and sisters. Disobedient. It's not all about Jesus. Verse 3. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as Yahweh, your Elohim of your ancestors, promised you. Look at verse 4. Because the reason why I came here is because of verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. One. Ayinworochiozo, we don't have any other God. We have no other God. There's only one God. The interesting thing is that even Christ himself would deny people, because they focus too much on him. They focus too much. We are not supposed to focus too much on Christ. As a matter of fact, it's not about Christ. You shouldn't focus not even a single second on Christ. Why? It's all about your Heavenly Father. It's all about your Heavenly Father. Let me show you. Let's go to Matthew. Matthew 6. Okay, Matthew 6. Matthew 6. Look at this. Matthew chapter 6. Even Christ himself agree with what I'm sharing with you right now. Remove your heart on Christ, I'm telling you. Remove your mind there, because he will distract you. Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. And you totally forget about keeping the law. It's all about the law. This is Matthew chapter 6. And when you pray, this is the word of Christ. And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the corner of the street, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. When you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. He's talking about your Father. So Christ is telling you that it's your Father, your Creator, God, our Creator, Chukwu Okike, in Igbo language, Yahweh, in Hebrew. He is the one that will reward you. That's what Christ is telling you. Christ is not the one that will reward you. Christ has no power. Every power belongs to the Most High. And Christ is not God. He was sent. He was sent. Oh my goodness. I don't know if you guys are sleeping. I don't know. But I'm sharing something very sensitive with you right now. This is not for everybody. 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. First Corinthians 15 is what I want to show you. I'm going to start from verse 21. Even Paul is going to agree with what I'm sharing with you today. Even Paul tell you the same thing. Notice how I'm reading from multiple translations. Okay. I've read like from three different translations already. So you don't want to get stuck on only one translation and thinking that that's the only better translation. No. Okay. I'm going to go down to from verse 21. Okay, let me start from verse 20. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians 15. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. Verse 21. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all shall be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ the first fruit, then at his coming those who belongs to Christ. Then, and yeah, Christ is going to come the second time too. Christ is coming again. But what did he say about the second coming? He said that he doesn't know when he's going to come. He said that, Matthew 24. He doesn't even know when he's going to come. Only the Father knows. So why are you focusing on the messenger instead of the Father? That makes no sense. It is not all about the messenger. It's all about the master. Our creator is our master. You have to be a fool to focus on the messenger instead of the person that sent the messenger. No, I want to deal with the master. That's who I want to deal with, not the messenger. The messenger doesn't have power. Messenger cannot do anything without the master. And that is what I'm about to show you right here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Then comes the end when he, meaning Christ, when he, Christ, delivers the kingdom to Elohim, the Father. So Christ is going to rule this world. Christ is going to rule until he destroyed the Gentile system, World Health Organization, World Bank, all this rubbish nonsense that these animals have set up in this world will be destroyed. And after everything, verse 24, 1 Corinthians 15, 24, then comes the end when he, Christ, delivers the kingdom to Elohim, the Father, after destroying every rule and every authority, like World Health, World Bank, all this nonsense thing that they created, Christ will destroy them all. After destroying every rule and every authority and power. Verse 25, for he must reign until he has, he must reign until, okay, for he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. Christ is going to reign, and God is going to put him in charge to reign. Yes, I believe that, and I'm looking forward. Oh my goodness, sometimes, oh my goodness. Do you know that sometimes I start mourning. Sometimes I'm pleading with Yah, please send Christ. Sometimes I'm longing for the second coming of Christ. I'm telling you. Sometimes I will start longing. Please, Father, can you send Christ to come? Please. I want him to come right now. Please. Because I know that as soon as Christ comes the second time, as soon as Christ comes, all this system in the world will stop. All the lying, all the stealing, all the oppression, all the evil going on in the world will stop. I hate this current world right now. I hate this system. I cannot wait for Christ to come and bring righteousness. Christ is coming to bring righteousness. He's coming back. Let me go to Malachi chapter 3 and show you that. Malachi chapter 3. Malachi chapter 3. Look at what it says. My brothers and sisters, can you hear me and see what I'm showing?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. So this is Malachi chapter 3. It says, behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. This is the Most High speaking. And he said that he's going to send his messenger. That messenger is Christ. Some people say that this is John the Baptist. No, it cannot be John the Baptist. And I'll show you why. I'll show you why this is not talking about. This messenger is not the John the Baptist. I'll show you why. And you will clearly see it. Malachi chapter 3 from verse 1. This has not happened yet. This is going to happen in the future. Yeshua HaMashiach is coming back. Yeshua HaMashiach is coming back for the second time to fulfill this. This thing is what you see here is exactly the same thing I'm reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Paul the apostle got what he wrote in 1 Corinthians from here. Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. Even the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says Yahweh of hosts. This messenger of the covenant is Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach. So the second coming is going to happen. Yeshua HaMashiach is coming back. Yahushua HaMashiach. Verse 2. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? So his second coming is going to be different from the first coming. The second coming is going to be coming to destroy the current system in the world. That is why he's asking you, who will be able to stand? Lawless people cannot stand. Unrighteous people cannot stand. Christ will be destroying a lot of system and a lot of people. For he is like a refiner's fire. Now, let me show you why this is not talking about John the Baptist. Let me show you why it's not talking about John the Baptist. For he is like a refiner's fire and like launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. he will purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to Yahweh an offering in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasant to Yahweh, as in the days of old, as in former years. And I will come near you for judgment. I will be a swift witness against sorcerers, adulterers, perjurers, and those who exploit wage earners and widows and orphans, and against those who turn away an alien, because they do not fear me, says Yahweh of hosts. For I am Yahweh, I do not change. So this is talking about the second coming of Christ. And I'm looking forward to that second coming of Christ. So that's Malachi chapter 3. If you go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I will continue from here. It's telling you that Christ is going to rule. Christ is going to rule. And after he finished ruling, Christ will hand over this world, the kingdom, Christ's kingdom. Christ will hand it over to our Heavenly Father. That is why there's going to be two kingdoms. The 1,000-year reign that Christ will rule, and then the everlasting kingdom that will come after the judgment day. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to Elohim, the Father, after destroying every rule. So within that 1,000-year reign, Christ is going to destroy and dismantle the system that the Europeans have created with the support of their father, the devil, according to Revelation chapter 13, verse 2. Revelation 13, 2 tells you that Satan gave his power, his throne, and authority to the beast. Let me read it. Revelation 13, 2. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon, which is the devil is the dragon, and the dragon gave to the beast, the dragon, Satan gave the beast, the dragon gave him his power, his seat, and great authority. That is the reason why the Europeans are sitting in the seat that they sit today. That is why they rule the world. And the Most High is beginning to dismantle them. So they get their power from Satan, as you can see from Revelation chapter 13, verse 2. Satan gave his power, his seat, and a great authority to the Europeans, as you see in Job 9:24, the earth has been given into the hands of the wicked. So back to 1 Corinthians. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to Elohim, the Father, after destroying every rule, every authority, and every power. For he, meaning Christ, this is Christ, talking about Christ in verse 25, 1 Corinthians 15:25. For he, Christ, must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For Elohim has put all things in subject under his feet. So God has put everything in subject under Christ's feet. But when it says all things are put in subjection, it is plain that he is accepted who put all things under subjection, under him. So it's saying that God has put everything under Christ. But God himself is not under Christ. That is what this is telling you. God himself is not under Christ. God put everything else under Christ. But he himself who put everything under Christ is not under Christ. It is plain that he is accepted who put all things in subjection under him. Verse 28, when all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who put all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. So at the end of the day, this is telling you that at the end of the day, when all is said and done, everything and everybody, including the Son, Christ, will be under God. Everyone will be under God. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It is not all about Jesus. It's all about the Most High. And most importantly, it's all about his law. It is all about his law. Let me go to Revelation 22, 14. Revelation 22, 14. Even Christ himself said it. He said it himself. It's all about the law. Look at the requirement into the kingdom. Look at the requirement that Christ gave you. Look at the requirement. Look. Blessed are those that do his commandment, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. The requirement into the kingdom of heaven is keeping the law. It is not faith. It is not grace. It is not faith. It is keeping the law. That is the requirement. And this is coming from Christ. Let us remove this emphasis and focus on Jesus, 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 Jesus. That's a wicked thing to believe, because it distracts you from what really matters. It distracts you from focusing on keeping the law. At the end of the day, it's all about the law. I showed you in Matthew 9, where even Christ himself, Matthew 9, 13 and 14, Christ himself said that he did not come for the righteous, but he came to bring sinners to repentance. He came to bring sinners to repentance. Another place that is on my mind right now is in Matthew chapter 4. Let me show you gospel. Let me show you the kind of gospel that Christ preached. I'm almost done. I'm pretty much done. I'm done. Those of you that want to understand, you can understand. Those of you that don't want to understand, you can misunderstand. It's up to you. I'm pretty much done. So let me show you the kind of gospel that Christ was preaching. Okay. Matthew 4:17. Look at the gospel that Christ was preaching. Look at this. From that time, Yeshua began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is the gospel that Christ was preaching. That is no longer the gospel that we preach today. We preach, believe in Jesus. Believe in Jesus. Believe in Jesus. That is the gospel that we preach today, to believe in Jesus. Have faith, grace. Oh my goodness, this is wicked. This is evil preaching. This is evil belief. It is not all about Jesus. It's all about God's law. I am showing you, look at the message that Christ was preaching. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Look at the requirement into the kingdom. Look at the requirement. This is Revelation 22, 14. Revelation 22, 14. The requirement into the kingdom is keeping the law. I mean, it's very clear. This is the word of Christ. This is the word of Christ. The requirement into the kingdom is keeping the law. There's another one that just came to my mind right now. Another one that came to my mind. Let's go to Matthew 7. Matthew 7. all these scriptures I'm showing you, they are coming to my mind right now. Let's go to Matthew 7. Matthew 7, I want to show you something that Christ said.
21 to 23.
Yes, 21 to 23. Look at this. This is the word of Christ. So you cannot say that, oh, what this is crazy. This is not biblical. Okay, look at what Christ said. Matthew 7, 21 to 23. It says, not everyone who calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone that calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. Because today it's all about Lord, Lord, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. But here, Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach himself is going to tell you what the requirement is. He's going to tell you what you have to do. Only those who do the will of, only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven will enter. On judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and performed many miracles in your name. But I will reply, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who broke God's law. It's all about keeping God's law. Christ is the one that told you that. I'm not the one that is telling you this. Christ is telling you that it's all about keeping God's law. That's what it's going to come down to. It's all about the law. It is not all about Jesus. It is absolutely not all about Jesus. It has nothing to do with Jesus. It's all about keeping the law. That is being obedient to our Creator. It's all about our Heavenly Father. Because we only have one God. We only have one God. We do not have two gods. Only one. One God. The Lord God is one. Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 4. Deuteronomy 6 verse 4. So we have to be careful not to create an idolatry system by which you focus on Christ. No. Christ came to bring us back to the law. He made it very clear. You see the requirement into the kingdom of heaven is keeping the law. That is Revelation 22:14. Revelation 22:14. Requirement into the kingdom of heaven is keeping the law. Christ said that when he returns, he is going to reject people because they broke God's law. Matthew 7:21-23. He will reject people because they did not keep the law. It's all about the law. Whatever we do, morning, night, evening, anytime, that just came to my mind right now. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. So whatever we do, it has to be all about the law. It's not about nothing else. It's all about the law. And when you keep the law, because I know that some people might be upset in what I'm saying. Some people might be like, may feel very, very offended. Some people might feel offended and feel like, no, it's not about the law. But think about it. Before you get offended, think about it. If I am pushing the law, right? If I'm telling you that it's not all about Jesus, it's all about keeping the law. Think about it before you get angry. Before you get upset with me, think about this. If I am pushing for us to keep the law, to focus on the law, what does that mean? That means obedient to our Creator. I am not promoting the law of my church. I am not promoting my church doctrine. I'm telling you to follow the law in your Bible. That's what I'm talking about. Follow those laws you see in your Bible. That is the only way. That's the passport. That is the way. The only way to the Father is to be obedient to his law. That is the only way. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy 6 from verse 6 to 9. Look at what the Most High said. Look at what the Most High said here. Deuteronomy 6, 6 to 9. If you read this, you see it's all about the law. This will show you that it's all about the law. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6 from verse 6 to 9. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. And you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlet between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. So the Most High is saying that we should talk about the law all the time. We should teach it to the children. And we should talk about it when we sit in our house, when we are walking on the street, when we lay down on our bed, and when we wake up in the morning. We should talk about the law all the time, all the time, all the time, all the time. It's all about the law. But this is not the only place. There's another place in chapter 11. Deuteronomy chapter 11, 18 and 19. Love and obedience rewarded. It's all about the law. It's all about the law. Therefore, you shall love Yahweh your Elohim and keep his charge, his statutes, his judgment, and his commandment always. Oh my goodness, oh my goodness. It says always. It actually says always. It actually says always. 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 Let's go down to verse 18. Verse 18 and 19. Verse 18 and 19. Verse 18 and 19. Therefore, you shall lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul, and bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlet between your eyes. You shall teach them to your children, speaking of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. It's all about the law. And you shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates, that your days and the days of your children may be multiplied in the land of which Yahweh swore to your fathers to give them. It's all about the law, my brothers and sisters. Let's remove this too much emphasis on Jesus, 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 Jesus. Let's remove that and focus on being obedient. That is the only thing that will make us to be right again with our Heavenly Father. That is what I want to share with you, my brothers and sisters. The devil have used his children to gather up writings of Paul, gather up history book like Matthew, Luke, John, put them together and then call them New Testament, and it becomes a distraction. It distracts us from what matters, which is the law. It's all about the law. It's all about the law. It's not all about Jesus. It's all about the law. Let's focus on keeping the law. I have shared the scriptures with you. You see it yourself. So the Most High cannot share his glory with anyone else, not even Christ. All glory goes to the Most High. Does anybody have any question, my brothers and sisters?
I just want to say I enjoyed the class, brother. Very good. Excellent class.
All praises to the Most High. I thank you for opening our eyes. This is more like a caution, to caution us to be careful. My brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, it's so easy. Let me tell you why this is important. It is so easy to backslide, to fall out of faith, maybe start doing something that I'm not supposed to do. And then I just, it's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's very easy. So that is why you see our people, we rely so much on Jesus and very little on the Father. Not much is talked about. Look at the Catholics. For the Catholics, it's all about Mary, 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 Mary. For the Catholics. It's all about Mary. For the Pentecostal, it's all about Jesus, 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 Jesus. Let me ask you guys a question, my brothers and sisters. What is it all about for the Israelite? Catholics is all about Mary. Pentecostal church is all about Jesus. When you read your Bible, who was the Israelite dealing with? It sounds like you don't know who the Israelites were dealing with. It sounds like you don't know.
Well, the Israelites was dealing with the creator of the heaven and the earth, and creator of the heaven and the earth gave us, the Israelites, the instructions in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 13. You know, he says when the, the scripture says, when you, in verse 12, he says, and now Israel, what do the Lord require of you? To fear the Lord thy God, walk in his ways, to love him, to serve him with all thy heart, mind, and soul. So we were dealing with God, the creator of the heaven and the earth, and he require that we obey his instructions and serve him. Yeah. So,
yeah. So yes. Just look at this picture. The Catholics, it's all about Mary, 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 Mary. You can't go to Catholic church and talk about Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. If you know the Catholic church, if you know them very well, it's all about Mary. Mary, 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 Mary. It's all about Mary, 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 Mary. For the Catholics. For the Pentecostal church, it's all about Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You cannot go to Pentecostal church and talk about Mary, Mary, Mary. No, the Pentecostal church will not allow it. It's not about Mary, it's all about Jesus. Now, when you open your Bible, you see that the Israelite is all about the Most High. It's all about our Heavenly Father, like the brother answered. It's all about our Heavenly Father. So where do you want to stand? Do you want to go and stand with the Catholics and it becomes all about Mary? Or do you want to stand with the Pentecostal? It's all about Jesus. Or do you want to stand with what you see in your Bible? It's all about the Most High. And how do you deal with the Most High? By being obedient to his word. His law is his word. If I say that we must follow his law, people will disagree. Oh no, we are not under the law. We are not under the law. If I say we must follow his word, people may not disagree that much. Let me show you this last place before we close. That revelation that you know about. I know you know about this. Revelation chapter, let's do 12 first, chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12. Let's look at this before we go to chapter 14. It said that the devil went after the children of the woman. The devil went after her children, those that keep the commandment, and the dragon was wrought with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandment of Elohim and have the testimony of Christ. My brothers and sisters, do you know what a testimony is? You know what a testimony is? I'm reading from King James right now. Does anybody know what a testimony is?
The Father's written word.
Okay. Who else?
Scripture itself, with the spirit of prophet.
Sorry, brother, could you repeat that?
You can hear me?
Yes.
It tells us that it is the spirit of prophet.
Okay. Who the else wants to? Okay. It's the spirit of prophecy, you said. Okay, so it says here that which keep the commandment of Elohim and have the testimony of Christ. So this is coming from the book of Revelation, and it's telling you that the devil is going to go after the children of the woman. That woman is Israel. You can study that some other time. But the devil will go after not all her children, but some of her children who keep the commandment and have the testimony. So testimony to testify, to testify. So I have testified to you that I believe that Christ existed. I believe that Christ was born of a virgin. I believe that Christ was sent by our Creator. I believe that Christ walked this world. I believe that Christ died on the cross. I believe that Christ went back to heaven. I believe that Christ is going to come back again when the Most High decides. I also believe that Christ said that he came to bring us back to the law. So I am not denying Christ. What I'm telling you is that it's not all about Christ. It's all about the law. It's all about being obedient to the laws of God, as you can see here. So I do have a testimony of Christ. I testify Christ. I do not deny Christ. But I'm telling you that it's all about the commandment. If you're keeping the commandment of the Most High, and you acknowledge, oh yes, I believe that Christ came. Oh yes, I believe that he came. Believing in Christ is not going to do you any good on the judgment day. Because the demons believe in Christ. The devil believe in Christ, as you can see in Luke chapter 4. Even the devil believe in Christ. So believing in Christ is not a big deal. The big deal is being obedient, as you can see here. This is Revelation chapter 12, 17. Revelation 12, 17. Let me go to the two more chapters after this.
Hallelujah.
Revelation 14, 14, that's going to be, let's go down. You see almost the same thing you saw on Revelation chapter 12, 17. This time is 12, chapter 14, verse 12. Revelation 14, 12. Here is the patience of the saint. Here are they that keep the commandment of Elohim and the faith of Yeshua. The faith of Yeshua. I'm reading from KJV. The faith of Yeshua. The faith of Yeshua. My brothers and sisters, do you notice something here? It says that here is the patient, because this is talking about the mark of the beast. This is talking about the mark of the beast. And it's telling you those who will resist the mark of the beast. Those who will not receive the mark of the beast are those who keep the commandment of God and the faith of Christ. My brothers and sisters, I want to ask you a question. Revelation 14, 12. You know what this one means because you're keeping the commandment. When it says, here is the patient of the saint, here are those that keep the commandment of God and the faith of Christ. Please, what does it mean, and the faith of Christ? What does that mean?
We believe he came and believe he is.
It's upon the definition of faith. Hebrews 11 and 1, I think it says that faith is the substance of thing hoped for, the evidence of thing not seen. We have to hope for, the kingdom that Christ is going to bring based upon the scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We have to hope for that kingdom. And how we hope for that kingdom, we have to accept all Christ's testimony. And Christ's testimony is making us, or is showing us that we have to keep God's law. So we have to, so that's the faith. Basically hoping for that kingdom that Christ is going to bring forth and holding on to his testimonies that he laid forth in the Gospels.
Okay. I like the ending of what you just said. Holding forth to the testimony he laid out in the Gospel. This is Revelation chapter 14, verse 12. And I have it here in multiple translations. It says, this calls for patience. This calls for patient endurance on the part of the people of God who keep his command and remain faithful to Jesus. That's New International Version. This means that God's holy people must endure persecution patiently, obeying his command and maintaining their faith in Christ. There's a reason why I'm showing you this, because I want to explain to you what it means to have faith in Christ. I want to explain to you what it means to have faith in Christ. Here is the call for the endurance of the saints who keep the commandment of God and their faith in Jesus. Berean Standard Translation. Okay, as soon as we remove this advertisement, okay. Berean Standard, Standard Bible. Here is a call for the perseverance of the saint who keep the commandment of God and the faith of Christ. Berean Literal Bible. Here is the endurance of the saint, those keeping the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And then this is one I read from earlier in KJV. Here is the patience of the saint. Here are they that keep the commandment of God and the faith of Christ. My brothers and sisters, when it says and the faith of Christ, it's basically like what the brother just explained. The faith of Christ that we're talking about here is simply that you know that Christ did a lot of teaching. Christ did a lot of teaching when he came, and he was teaching people about the law. Let me give you an example. Let's go to Matthew. And I thank the Most High for the ability I have to share my screen. As we're talking about this, we're looking at it right away, going into it. Let's go to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew 5. Let me show you what I mean that Christ was teaching about the law. Matthew 5. Let's go to from verse. Go to verse 31 and 32. Okay, he was teaching about marriage. He says, furthermore, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that whoever divorces his wife for any reason, except sexual immorality, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery. Now, this thing that Christ is saying here, he's actually quoting from the law in Deuteronomy 22. He's getting this from the law. So Christ was teaching the law. And understand that during the time of Christ, let me show you what I mean. Let's go to Luke chapter 21. Luke 21. And I thank you for bringing out all the scriptures that are coming up right now. And then we're going to them. I'm very grateful to the Most High, because there's nothing like going through this and seeing the evidence. Luke 21, let's go down all the way to the end. Luke 21, all the way to the end. Luke 21, 37. Luke 21, 37. And in the daytime, he was teaching in the temple. My brothers and sisters, I want to ask you a question. How come Christ did not go and start his new church How come he did not go and start a new church? Why was Christ sitting over there in the temple every day? I am showing you. I am not telling you. I am showing you that Christ did not start a new church. Christ was teaching in the temple, the same place that the Pharisees and the scribes was. That was where Christ was teaching. Christ did not create any new church. He did not. And in the daytime, he was teaching in the temple, but at night, he went out and stayed on the mountain called Olivet. Then early in the morning, all the people came to him in the temple to hear him. I am using this to show you what it means to have faith in Christ. These people came early in the morning to hear Christ teach the law. So if you believe those things that he was teaching, that means you have faith with them. My brother, my sister, if I tell you right now, my brother, my sister, come and follow me. Let's go into a plane. We're going to fly in a plane. And I tell you that I know how to fly plane. Because you know me, you trust me. You will follow me. You will obey me. You follow me. You're not going to say no. Unless if you have other reason, maybe you don't have time. But my point is that if you don't know me, you will not have faith in my word. You will not have faith in my word. I think I'm doing a bad job in using myself as an example. Let me use Abraham. That's a perfect example. The Most High told Abraham to go and sacrifice his son. Abraham was described as the father of faith. You see that faith in action by Abraham standing up to go and do what the Most High asked him to do. So the point I'm trying to make is that when you talk about the faith in Christ, faith in Christ, faith in Christ, faith in Christ, it simply means that you believe what Christ said. It simply means that when Christ tells you in Revelation, when Christ tells you, like right here, blessed are those that do his commandment. They are the ones who have the right to the tree of life and may live forever. My brothers and sisters, what is the tree of life? What is the tree of life?
The tree of life is what Adam was had in Genesis chapter 3 when Adam and Eve ate the forbidden fruit. You know, within that chapter, it shows that the Lord placed them out of the garden. Because if they had eaten the tree of life, they would have received immortality. That tree of life is like a tree that's there. When we eat of it, we receive eternal life. So that's what the tree of life is.
Okay, yes, you're right. The tree of life, Adam and Eve broke the law. They were prevented. They were kicked out from the Garden of Eden. And the Most High put an angel to guard the tree of life. So you now see, that was in Genesis. You now see in Revelation telling you that those who will be allowed to eat from the tree of life are those who keep the commandment. If you believe what Christ said here, that means you have faith in him. If you do not have faith in him, you will not believe this. As a matter of fact, Christians don't even believe this. Christians don't believe this. They do not. And I will show you why I said they don't believe this. In this same place, if you read it in other translation, they will say those that wash their robe, they water it down. Instead of saying those that do his commandment, they say those that wash their robe. So my point is that having faith in Christ simply means believing the things that he was teaching. You know, faith, I believe in you. I have faith in you. I trust you. Faith, believe, trust, they all go along. And today we call it, we don't say, oh, I have faith in you. I have faith in you. I have faith in you. I have faith in him. I have faith in her. We don't speak like that anymore today. I believe in you. I trust you. We use the word trust. We've now used trust to replace belief and faith. So back then, they were saying faith. So because Christ was teaching a lot of things from the law. So if you trust him, you will keep the law. Because do you think it's an accident? You think it's an accident that they mention those that keep the commandment? Here is the patient of the saint. Here are they that keep the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus. It simply means that they're keeping the commandment and they also believe the things that Christ was teaching. And what was Christ teaching us? Christ was teaching us that we have to keep the law in order to be accepted by God. Very simple. Very, very simple. So let us focus on obeying our Creator. Let us focus on keeping his commandment. Because like Christ told us, the requirement into the kingdom of heaven is keeping the law. The requirement is not believing in Christ. The requirement is keeping the law. That is the requirement into the kingdom of heaven. The requirement into the kingdom of heaven is keeping the law. Right here. Christ tells you. Right here. In Matthew 7. Matthew 7. Not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord. It is not all about Jesus. It's all about obedience to God. It's all about obedience to the laws of God. We should focus our energy. We should focus our time. We should focus on our effort in obeying the laws and the commandment of God, learning the laws and the commandment of God, and keeping the laws and the commandment of God. That's what this is all about. Even Christ tells you in Matthew 7, right here. But I will reply, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who broke God's law. You who broke God's law. Christ will reject people on that day because they broke God's law. Matthew 7. 21 to 23 in New Living Translation. In KJV, in King James Version, it says, you who did iniquity, you who walk iniquity. In New Living Translation, in New King James Version, it says, you who practice lawlessness. It's all about the laws of God. Stop focusing on Jesus. Start focusing on keeping the laws of God. That is the only way to go. That is the only way to get into the kingdom of heaven. That is the only requirement that God wants us to follow. It's all about obeying God. It's all about keeping his law. Does anybody right here have any question, my brothers and sisters, before I turn to those who are on YouTube? Anybody have any question? All right. So to you, my brothers.
Brother.
Sure, go ahead.
I have a question about praying. You know, in Matthew, when it says to pray, our Father who art in heaven. Now, what about when you want to pray and ask for forgiveness or pray for someone else? How should you be doing so?
I think this question is a little bit, it's a different topic, right?
Yes.
Okay, we'll come back to that. Because this particular topic right here is about focusing on obeying our Heavenly Father. So that if something happens, we don't justify lawlessness. We don't go on to justify breaking the law. Because we're banking and hoping that, yeah, I believe in Jesus. I have faith in Jesus. No. Christ said that he would deny people on that day, and he would deny them because they did not keep the law. So it is not enough to call about Jesus, Lord, 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 as you can see here. Not everyone that calls out to me, Lord, 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 Jesus, 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 Jesus. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. No. He says, not everyone that calls out to me, Lord, Lord. The only people that will matter on the judgment day are those that keep God's law. But I will reply, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who broke God's law. It's all about God's law. Let us focus on that. If you happen to be watching this video on YouTube and you have any question, you are more than welcome to give me a call. Don't even bother caring about when you place that call. You can call me anytime. I am always on call for the Most High. My phone is always available most of the time. You can give me a call if you have any question regarding this. Now, okay, brother, go ahead. Like as I asked before, please, if someone else have a question, please make sure your question is about this topic. Please, I don't want to deviate to a different topic. Let's close this and go to a different topic if you want to ask something else. But we're focusing on this topic right now because this is a very important topic. We have brothers and sisters out there who do not focus on keeping the law because they have this imaginary faith in Christ. Imaginary faith. And on that day, what you see here in Matthew 7 will happen to them. They will come, oh, Jesus, Lord, Jesus, oh, Jesus, Father, Jesus. Christ will say, get away from me. Get away from me. I don't know who you are because you did not keep the law. That is why this topic is very important. Brother, go ahead. What's your question?
So my question is that if we have Muslim people, there are Muslim people, could it be if a Muslim person believe that because Muslim people, what they preach is that they believe in Jesus Christ, as they believe what the Bible wrote about Jesus, except that they don't believe that there are three in one, like the Trinity. You can normally watch that debate. So if they believe in, because the way I'm looking at it, I'm trying to relate it to, because Muslim people believe there's only one God. And they believe that Jesus Christ, that he was born and things like that. But the bottom line I want to put is that we as Hebrew Israelites, because it's more or less like it's similar to what Muslim people preach from this topic. So can we say that they can make it into the kingdom if a Muslim person believe what we believe and they is praying according to Islam? Because I saw a video that they are even a video that revealed that Muhammad and the rest of them, they are black people. So I was going to share with the group. So can we say a Muslim person can make it into the kingdom based on exactly what we believe and they is just praying in a Muslim or is following of praying in a Muslim way?
Okay, so this is God's requirement into the kingdom. I'm not going to tell you what I think is a requirement. I'm just going to show you what the Most High say you have to do to be allowed into his kingdom. And that is Revelation chapter, Isaiah chapter 56, right here. Salvation for foreigners. Salvation for foreigners. Isaiah chapter 56. Salvation for foreigners. Muslims are not Israelites. Muslims are foreigners. So what we read here is going to cover Muslims. It's going to cover Chinese, the Mexicans, the non-Israelite, foreigners, salvation for foreigners. Your question is about Muslims. They don't believe in Jesus as in the way that Christians do. They just believe that Christ existed. That's what they believe, but they don't focus on Christ, which is exactly what I'm asking you not to do. Do not focus on Christ. It's not all about Christ. It's all about obedience to the laws of God. It's all about obedience to the word of God, keeping the commandment. That's what it's all about. So this is the answer to your question right here in Isaiah chapter 56. This is what the Most High said about the strangers, the non-Israelite, and having salvation. This is what the Most High says. that says Yahweh, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my righteousness be revealed. Blessed is the man who does this, the man who does this, and the Son of Man who hold it fast. So your Creator is about to tell you what you have to do to have salvation. This is not what I'm telling you. I am not telling you this. I am about to show you, or I am showing you, what your Creator says in the book of Isaiah, chapter 56, that you and everybody else must do to have salvation. And there is no verse here that talks about believing in Jesus. As we continue to read, it says, thus says Yahweh, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my righteousness be revealed. Blessed is the man who does this, and the Son of Man who hold fast, who hold it fast, who keeps the Sabbath, not profaning it, and keeps his hand from doing any evil. What is profaning, my brothers and sisters? What is profane?
Profaning is when you doing defilement. It's when you are defiling something. So like when the Israelites when the Israelites had transgressed the law, they put abominations in the temple of the Lord to profane his name. So profaning is actually doing anything to defile, it's anything that relates to defilement.
Okay, you know, like, so go ahead. Sorry, thought you're done.
Yeah, so like, you know, it's when it comes to the Sabbath, when we work and do other things that is not related to the Sabbath regulations, we profane that day. So profaning is defilement, is definition.
Exactly. You know, if the Most High say keep the Sabbath, I cook on that day, I'm profaning the Sabbath. If I buy on that day, I'm profaning the Sabbath. If I do something I'm not supposed to do on the Sabbath, like cooking, buying, selling, going to work, I'm profaning the Sabbath. If I do not go for worship on that day. So, the Most High is telling us what we have to do to have salvation. Blessed is the son. Blessed is the man who does this. Now he's going to go on to give you the list of what you have to do to have salvation. Because this is talking about salvation right here. Isaiah 56. Isaiah 56 from verse 1. That says Yahweh Elohim, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my righteousness be revealed. Blessed is the man who does this, and the Son of Man who hold fast, who hold it fast. That is the person who is doing it perfectly, who is doing it well. That is the Son of Man who hold it fast, the person who is doing it very well. Who keeps the Sabbath from polluting it, meaning that they're not breaking the Sabbath. The person is not breaking the Sabbath. They're doing what they're supposed to do on that day. They don't buy, they don't sell, they don't cook. Who keeps the Sabbath from profaning it and keeps his hand from doing any evil? Verse 3. Let not the foreigner who has joined himself to Yahweh say, Yahweh will surely separate me from his people. And let not the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. So the unique are people who cannot have children, men who cannot have children. The Most High is saying that they shouldn't worry. Even if they don't have children, the Most High will still allow them into his kingdom. If they do this, look at verse 4. For thou says Yahweh, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbath, who choose the thing that please me. We're supposed to choose what pleases Yah. It does not please Yah when a man shave his beard. It does not please Yah when anybody lie. It does not please Yah when I break the Sabbath. It does not please Yah when I deceive people. It does not please Yah when I do the things that he told me in his law not to do. For thou says Yahweh, to the eunuch who keep my Sabbath, who choose the things that please me, and hold fast my covenant, my brothers and sisters, it does not please the Most High for you to send your children to school. Because in school, they are teaching your children that the world has no creator. It does not please the Most High for you to be sending your children to school. So even though there might not be a law that says don't send them to school in 2022, it doesn't please the Most High for you to be sending your child where they'll be teaching things against the law. For thou says Yahweh, to the eunuch who keep my Sabbath, and who choose what the thing that pleases me, and hold fast to my covenant. My brothers and sisters, do you know what the covenant of God is?
Yes, the covenant is the agreement the Creator made with our ancestors in a time when he gave them the law, Exodus 19 to Exodus 20. He told them, if we obey his instructions, which is his commandments, his laws, his statutes, then he would give us the land of inheritance. Exactly. The covenant is the agreement that the Creator made with our ancestors.
Exactly. And this is Deuteronomy chapter 29. Deuteronomy chapter 29 tells you exactly what that covenant is. Deuteronomy 29, it says, these are the words of the covenant which Yahweh commanded Moses to make with the children of Israel in the land of Moab, beside the covenant which he made with them in Horeb. The law of God is the words of the covenant. The laws of our Heavenly Father is the words of the covenant. The laws of our Heavenly Father is the words of the covenant. So back to Isaiah chapter 56. Isaiah 56, going on the question that the brother asked about salvation for the Muslims and believing in Jesus. I'm using Isaiah chapter 56 to show you how to have salvation. This has nothing to do with Jesus. Salvation has nothing to do with Jesus, according to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 56 came from that God that said that he changes not. He changed not. So he's already telling you through Isaiah what you have to do to have salvation. And what do we have to do? It's very clear. Very, very, very clear. He tells us here. For thou says Yahweh, Isaiah 56:4, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbath, who choose the things that please me, and hold fast to my covenant. The covenant of God is his law. The Israelites are being punished today because they broke the law. When you break the law, you've broken the covenant. When you keep the law, you've kept the covenant. The Most High said, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters. The reason why the Most High is talking about eunuch, because the eunuchs, they cannot have children. For example, Acts chapter 8, the Ethiopian eunuch. Acts chapter 8, Ethiopian eunuch. He couldn't have a child. So people like that, they feel bad because they couldn't have child. Because they have been castrated. They're eunuchs. They couldn't have child. So the Most High is saying that even if you are a eunuch, even if you are a eunuch, because the Most High is giving an example here in Isaiah 56, example of those who will receive salvation. The Most High is saying, even if you are a eunuch, even if you are a non-Israelite, if you keep his Sabbath and keep the rest of his laws, you will have salvation. I will give it my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And the foreigners who join themselves to Yahweh, to minister to him, to love the name of Yahweh, and to be his servant, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it, and hold fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. Yahweh, who gathers the outcast of Israel, declares, I will gather yet others to him beside those who are gathered. So if the Muslims keep the laws and the commandment and keep the Sabbath, they will have salvation, according to Isaiah 56. If the Muslims keep the law and the commandment and keep the Sabbath, they will have salvation. The same requirement applies to everybody. The same requirement applies to everybody. The scripture that just came to my mind right now is Numbers 15. Let's look at Numbers 15. Numbers 15. From verse 15 and 16. Numbers chapter 15, 15 and 16. One ordinance shall be for you of the assembly and for the stranger who dwells with you, an ordinance forever throughout your generations. As you are, so shall the stranger be before Yahweh. One law and one custom shall be for you and for the stranger who dwells with you. So it's all about the law, my brothers and sisters. This is the requirement that God has. Salvation is not about Christ. Salvation is about being obedient to God. Let me close from where I started. Let me remind you that if you think of the problem in the Garden of Eden, they broke the law. Think of all the people that the Most High have problem with. All the people that have problem with our Heavenly Father is always disobedient to the law. So my brother, in terms of your question about the Muslims, if they keep the law and the commandment, they will have salvation. The same requirement applies to everybody. Everybody. Even Paul the Apostle tells you that in Romans 2:13. Romans 2:13 was talking about the judgment day. Romans 2:13 was talking about the judgment day. And even Paul tells you in Romans 2:13 that it's not the hearers of the law are just. It is the doers of the law. It is those that obey the law. They are the ones who will be justified on that judgment day. Romans chapter 2, verse 13. Paul makes it very clear. For not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified. Romans chapter 2 is talking about judgment day. Romans chapter 2 is talking about judgment day. And those who will be accepted on that day, according to Romans chapter 2, 13, are those that keep the law. They are the ones who will be justified by our Heavenly Father. So my brothers and sisters, and my brother that asked the question, brother Hallelujah, that asked the question, for the Muslims and for non-Muslims, for non-Israelite, for Israelite, for everybody, the requirement into the kingdom of heaven is the same. We have to keep the law. We must start keeping the law. That's what it's all about. It's not about Jesus. It's not about believing in Jesus. It's all about keeping the law. That is the requirement. I even showed you Revelation 22:14. I showed you even Christ himself also told you that the requirement into the kingdom is keeping the law. Revelation 22:14 that I showed you, even Christ himself said it. Blessed are they that do his commandment, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gate into the city. Even Christ are telling you this. For without our dogs, outside, those who will not be able to come in, without our dogs, sorcerers, and whoremongers, murderers, idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. So that is the situation we have right now. We should focus on keeping the law. My brother, your question about the Muslims have to do the same thing. The Muslims are not wrong. They are not wrong when they say that Christ was the messenger. Christ was the messenger. They are not wrong when they say that Christ was a prophet. Christ was a prophet. If you look at Luke 21, Christ was prophesying the destruction of Jerusalem. Christ prophesied the destruction of Jerusalem, and Jerusalem was destroyed. Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD. He prophesied it in Luke 21, and it happened. Christ was the prophet. Christ was the messenger of God, as you see in Malachi chapter 3. And the Muslims are right on that. The Muslims also focus on worshiping only God, only one God. They are also right on that. So all they have to do now is to keep the Sabbath and keep the rest of the laws. Then they will have salvation, according to Isaiah chapter 56 that we just read. So does that answer your question, my brother? Sorry, we can close this. I don't want this to be, because this is a very, very important topic that will challenge our brothers and sisters. I know this kind of message will challenge people. And I want them people to reflect and think about this so they can focus on keeping the law and not have an imaginary faith, a fake faith that will lead you on that day Christ will deny you, because you focus on having faith in Christ and then you don't focus on keeping the laws and the commandment which you have to keep. Brother, does that answer your question, my brother? Before we
Yes, very, very well. Very, very well. The other part that I just want to double check is the part of the salvation that because the Christian churches teaches that it's through the Christ that we can have that we can be saved. And I see some websites like the website 28.org has a lot of debate and article that they don't believe that Christ, they believe that it's through the David, King David, that will be saved, that Christ is not our savior. That's the first question. The second one is where we are praying. Is where we are praying. Can we still use the name of Christ to be able to ask that, we pray in the name of Yeshua, that we ask in his name? Because there are scripture that says, whatever we ask in his name, that shall be given. So to be able to know apart from being a prophet, what are the other benefits that we can go through Christ to be able to assess? So that's the question. Thank you, brother.
Yeah, so for example, speaking of the name, Matthew 28, it says, go into all the world, baptizing, teaching people everything that I've commanded you. Teaching people what I command you, baptizing them, or teaching people what I taught you, baptizing them in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit. There's a reason why I'm telling you this right now. What I'm telling you right now, I'm telling you this for a reason. Just pay close attention so you can see what I'm trying to show you right now. In Matthew 28, let me go there. Matthew 28, towards the end of Matthew 28. So if you go towards the end, towards the end, it says, verse 19, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father. My brothers and sisters, what is the name of the Father? We're talking about name. Brother asked me a question about praying in Jesus' name. Should we be praying in Jesus' name?
Yahweh.
Okay. What is the name of the Son? Yeshua. Okay. Listen, look at this. Okay. Remember, pay attention to this. The brother asked me, should we be praying in the name of Jesus? That was the question. And I'm trying to use the Bible to answer that question. Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father. We know the name of the Father. I ask you also, you told me what the name of the Father is. I ask, what is the name of the Son? Yeshua. And of the Holy Spirit, you are told to baptize with the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So you are told to baptize with three names. You should go there and baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So you know the name of the Father. You know the name of the Son. What is the name of the Holy Spirit?
The Holy Spirit has no name.
But he says to baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit. So what name do you use? Let's say I have a brother or sister who is sitting down and they want to get baptized. Like we're going to have in the upcoming feast. No, not upcoming feast, the next Feast of Tabernacle. We're going to be baptizing people. So if you're interested in baptizing and you're going to come for the feast, you get ready because we're going to be baptizing people during that feast. So the thing is that if you have people that you're going to baptize and they're kneeling down in front of you in the water and Christ told you to baptize in the name of the Father, you know the name of the Father. Baptize in the name of the Son, you know the name of the Son. He also said baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit. What chapter and verse tells you the name of the Holy Spirit? That's my question. What is the chapter and the verse in the Bible that tell you the name of the Holy Spirit? Please tell me if you know.
There's none.
The Holy Spirit has no name. So why is he telling you to baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit when the Holy Spirit has no name? Why am I pointing this out? The brother asked me about praying in the name of the Son. Praying in the name of the Son. And I'm using this one as an example. Because if I told you that you're not supposed to baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit, some of you might get upset. Some of you will not say anything. But in your heart, you start thinking, oh my goodness, Brother Tobiah is beginning to drift away. Brother Tobiah is beginning to become anti-Bible. How can he say we cannot baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit? But Jesus said we should baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit. But what you may not think is what I'm trying to get you to think. What is the name of the Holy Spirit? You were clearly told to baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit. So what is that name then? You realize that there's no name for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has no name. The Holy Spirit has no name. So why is he telling you to baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit? Now let's take it back to the question that the brother asked. Praying in the name of the Son. Whatever you ask in the name of the Son. Whatever you ask in the name of the Son will be done for you. My brothers and sisters, that name of the Son is not Jesus. That name of the Son is not Christ. That name of the Son is not Yeshua. What that name of the Son, for example, let me give you an example. Christ said that I came in my Father's name, you reject me. Another will come in his own name, he you will accept. My brothers and sisters, when he says that whatever you pray in Jesus' name, or when Christ says, I came in my Father's name, or when Christ says, baptize in the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Ghost, it is not talking about actual name. No. It's talking about represent. Name means represent. Like answering somebody's name. Name, represent. If I say, for example, if I say Android, if you hear Android, what is it that comes to your mind, my brothers and sisters? Android, what comes to mind?
A phone device.
A phone. Android, you think, next thing you think is a phone. Android is a name, but it represents something. It represents something. So it's not talking about the actual name. When it says to whatever you ask in Jesus' name or in Yeshua's name, it simply means that, again, if you believe on the things that he was teaching and you are practicing what he was teaching, which is the law, if you are practicing it, then whatever you ask, because you are practicing what he was teaching. And by the way, how do we know that he was teaching the law? Let's go to Matthew chapter 9 or Matthew 15. How do we know that he was teaching the law? Because the Bible tells us what he was teaching. The Bible makes it very, very clear what he was teaching. So there's no confusion about what he was teaching, which Christians and most people don't know what he was teaching. Look here in Matthew chapter 15. Traditions and commandment. Traditions and commandment. Traditions and commandment. Now let's see who is teaching who and who is teaching what. Then Pharisees and scribes came to Yeshua from Jerusalem and said, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat. He answered them, and why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition? For God commanded, honor your mother, honor your father and your mother. And whoever rivals father or mother must surely die. But you say, if anyone tells his father or his mother, what you should have gained from me is given to God, he need not honor his father. So for the sake of your tradition, you have made void the word of God. You hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you when he said, these people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandment of men. So I'm showing you this for you to see that Christ was bringing back to the law. The people that was around during the time of Christ was no longer teaching the commandment of God. And Christ came to bring back the commandment of God. So praying in the name of Christ simply means representing Christ, in the sense that if you are practicing what he preached, if you trust on the teaching that he taught you that you have to keep the law, for example, let me give you an example of where he was teaching that you have to keep the law. Matthew. So this place I'm about to show you right now is the most clearest place that showed that Christ was teaching that we have to keep the law. Then Yeshua, Matthew 23, verse 1 to 3. Then Yeshua said to the crowd and to his disciples, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees are the official interpreters of the law of Moses. Let me stop here in verse 1 and 2. Then Yeshua said to the crowd, Christ said to the crowd, that the teachers of religious law, ndinekuzi, iwu, people that teach the law, and the Pharisees, they are the official interpreters of the law of Moses. That is what Christ was telling his disciples, that these Pharisees and the scribes, they are the official interpreters. They are the ones teaching the law of Moses. Look at verse 3. So, practice and obey whatever they tell you. So, Christ was telling his followers that the Pharisees are the official, and the scribes are the official teachers. They were teaching the law of Moses. So, practice everything they teach you in the law of Moses. So, practice and obey whatever they tell you, but don't follow their example, for they don't practice what they teach. They crush people with unbearable religious demand and never lift a finger to ease the burden. My brothers and sisters, you can clearly see in Matthew 23, verse 1 to 3, that Christ was teaching the law of Moses. Christ was telling his followers to keep the law of Moses. So if you say you believe in Christ, if you say you have faith in Christ, but you do not keep the law of Moses, you are deceiving yourself. You are lying. If you trust Christ, you will be keeping the law of Moses because Christ said so. So praying, if you say you believe in Christ, but you do not keep the law of Moses that Christ told you to keep in Matthew 23, right here. Matthew 23, verse 1 to 3. If I say I believe in Christ, if I say I trust in Christ, if I say I have my faith in Christ, if I say I believe in Christ, if I say I trust Christ, if I say I follow Christ, but I do not keep the law of Moses, but when I pray, I am praying in Jesus' name, that prayer will not be answered. That prayer will not be answered. That prayer will not be answered. I say I believe in Christ. I say I have faith in Christ. I pray in Jesus' name. God, please help me in Jesus' name. God, heal me in Jesus' name. But I do not keep the law. The prayer will not be answered, as you see in Proverbs 28, verse 9. Proverbs 28, verse 9 makes it very clear that that prayer will not be answered. It will not be answered. Proverbs 28, verse 9. That prayer will not be answered. No matter how long I pray, no matter how serious I pray, it doesn't matter. The prayer will not be answered. Proverbs 28, verse 9. Let me pull it up. Proverbs 28, verse 9. Actually, let me read this before I continue. Let me read it from this translation. It says, this is NIV, and the Christians have watered it down. Christians watered this down. What do they say? Look at what they said. Look at the way they translate it. If anyone turns a deaf ear to my instruction, even their prayer is detestable. What is the instructions of God? What is his instructions? Because instead of putting the law, they put instructions. You see? Because they don't want to use the word the law in NIV. This is NIV. Instead of putting the word law, they put instructions. Okay, let's go back and look at other translations. Proverbs 28, verse 9. Proverbs 28, verse 9. One who turns away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer is an abomination. Yes. So the thing is that I can believe in Jesus all I want. I can have my faith in Jesus all I want. But if I am not keeping the law, I can pray, I can shout in Jesus' name all I want. That prayer will not be answered. So the point I'm making is that when it says to pray in the name of Jesus or pray in the name of Yeshua, it's not talking about physical name. It's talking about doing what Christ wants us to do, which is to keep the law. If you're keeping the law, then your prayer will not be an abomination. So I gave you an example with go and baptize people in the name of the Father. We know the name of the Father. We know the name of the Son. But what is the name of the Holy Spirit? Because you're told to baptize in the name of the Holy Spirit. So if I am baptizing somebody, I'm not going to stand over there and say, brother or sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Yahweh. I baptize you in the name of the Son, Yeshua. I baptize you in the name of Holy Spirit. No, that would be a childish way of doing baptism, because it's not talking about physical name. If you say it's talking about physical name, then tell me the name of the Holy Spirit then. Tell me the name of the Holy Spirit. No, it's all about this person. Are they keeping the law? It's all about the law. It is all about the law. The evil one do not want you to know it's all about the law. It is all about the law. It is nothing else. It is not about faith. It is not about belief. It is not about grace. It is all about the law. Again, like as I said before, if you look at those people that God has problem with in the past, the only thing that causes problem between Chineke and people is breaking the law. Chineke is God in Igbo language. The only thing that causes problem is when people start breaking his law. As soon as they start keeping his commandment, things will come back to normal. Period. That is what it's all about. A scripture just came to my mind right now, and I will close with that. That's Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel 18. I will close with that because I want to give opportunity to those who are on YouTube who may have questions for you too. I don't want to overwhelm you with too much information. I want to think about everything that you had today. And then feel free to give me a call if you have any question regarding what you just heard. Okay? The purpose of this presentation is for you to focus on keeping the law. Look at Ezekiel chapter 18. And we're going to close with this chapter. Ezekiel 18. I want to show you what the Most High said we have to do for him to forgive us. What we have to do for him to forgive us. This is the coming from Ezekiel chapter 18. This is the requirement we have to meet before God will forgive us. Let's go down from verse 20. Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel chapter 18. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. Look at verse 21. But if the wicked will turn from all his sins that he had committed, that is all of us have committed sin. All of us have broken God's law in one way or the other. All of us, including me, we have all broken the law of God in one way or the other. I am showing you Ezekiel chapter 18 from verse 21. Ezekiel 18 from verse 21. So that you can see the requirement that our Creator laid out that we must meet, we must follow in order for him to forgive us. Ezekiel chapter 18 from verse 21. This is not all about Jesus. This has nothing to do with Jesus. Look at the word of your God. I am reading from Ezekiel chapter 18 from verse 21, New King James Version. Look at the requirement. I showed you from Isaiah chapter 56. The requirement to have salvation has nothing to do with Jesus. Isaiah 56. Go and read it. Now I'm showing you requirement for forgiveness. Before God will forgive us, this is the requirement right here. But if the wicked, will turn from his, from all his sins that he had committed, and keep all my statutes, and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live. He shall not die. My brothers and sisters, what is the statutes of God?
The statutes is how we observe the law. How we observe the law given.
Who did God give his statutes to give us?
The Lord gave his statutes to the children of Israel.
Who did he give it to give us? Who?
The Levites.
Moses was a Levite. Moses was, Aaron's brother. Aaron was a Levite. Moses was Aaron's brother. The point is that the statutes of God, the laws of God, the ordinance of God, the commandment of God was given to us through Moses. The Most High God is saying that in order for us to be forgiven, no matter what we've done, we must, first of all, Ezekiel chapter 18 from verse 21, but if the wicked will turn from all his sins. What is sin according to the Bible, my brothers and sisters? What is sin according to the Bible?
It's the transgression of the law.
The breaking of the law. 1 John 3:4. Breaking of the law. If I start breaking God's law, I am committing sin. That is the biblical definition of sin. 1 John 3:4. 1 John 3:4. But if the wicked will turn from all his sins that he had committed and keep all my statutes and do that which is all his law, and do that which is lawful, law, according to the law of God. If the person do that which is lawful, keeping God's law, and right, he shall surely live. He shall not die. Look at verse 22. All his transgressions that he had committed, they shall not be mentioned unto him. All the transgression, all the breaking of the law, all the lying, all the stealing, all the oppression, all the cheating, all the evil that that person did in the past will never be mentioned again. If that person will go back to the law, oh my goodness, this is good news. No matter what you did in the past, if you will go back and begin to keep the law of God, he will not mention those things you did in the past. Ezekiel chapter 18, 22. All his transgressions that he had committed, they shall not be mentioned unto him. In his righteousness that he had done, he shall live. The righteousness that he has done, he shall live. My brothers and sisters, what is righteousness? According to the Bible.
Righteousness is when we keep the commandments. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 25.
Exactly.
Righteousness is when the first command.
Keeping the law, that is righteousness. Including Psalm 119, 172 also. Psalm 119, 172. Psalm 119, 172. Say that his commandment is righteousness. Righteousness is keeping the commandment, like my brother said. Righteousness is keeping the law. The Most High said that all his transgressions that he had committed, you have committed, they shall not be mentioned unto you anymore. Your righteousness, meaning that now that you're keeping the law, your righteousness that he had done, he shall live. Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, says Yahweh Elohim, and not that he should return from his ways and live? Look at verse 24, Ezekiel 18, 24. But when the righteous, the person who is keeping the law, is the righteous. Luke 1, 5 and 6. Luke chapter 1, 5 and 6. Luke chapter 1, 5 and 6. Elizabeth, Zechariah, the mother and the father of John the Baptist, that couple, that husband and wife, they were righteous. According to Luke chapter 1, 5 and 6, they were righteous. They kept all the laws and the commandments perfectly. A righteous person is the person that keeps the laws of God. Luke chapter 1, 5 and 6. Luke chapter 1, verse 5 and 6. But when the righteous, the person who is keeping the law, but when the righteous turned away from his righteousness and committed iniquity, iniquity is breaking the law, and do it according to all the abomination that the wicked man do it, shall he live? All his righteousness that he had done shall not be mentioned. In his trespass that he had trespassed, and in his sin that he had sinned, in them shall he die. So, my brothers and sisters, I am clearly showing you Ezekiel chapter 18, where the Most High talks about his condition for forgiveness. This condition for forgiveness has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. The condition for forgiveness is that you have to go back and start keeping the law. All the sins you committed in the past will be not mentioned to you again. I am showing you Ezekiel. Please, if I am lying, you can call me on the phone and tell me. If I'm showing you something here that is not sane, I'm reading from New King James Version. Or from King James. I think this is King James or something. Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel chapter 18, the Most High God is telling you. It's King James. Ezekiel chapter 18. The Most High is telling you the condition for his forgiveness. What you have to do for him to forgive you. You have to start keeping the law. It has nothing to do with Christ. Open your eyes, my brothers and sisters. Please don't kill the messenger. Don't shoot the messenger. I'm simply showing you this from the Word of God. Remove your attention and focus on Christ. Focus it on keeping the law. Whatever you have done in the past, your God said that if you go back and start keeping his law and his commandment, he will forgive you. This is why we have to focus on keeping the laws and the commandment. Because at the end of the day, when you go up, down, left, right, front, back, at the end of the day, go wherever you want to do, go, do whatever you want to do. At the end of the day, it comes down back to keeping the law. When it comes to forgiving our sins, we have to go back to the law. It has nothing to do with Christ. It's all about the law. When it comes to having salvation, Isaiah chapter 56 that I showed you, Isaiah 56, it's all about the law. It's always been all about the law. It's all about the law. Always. And will always be all about the law. Anybody who is telling you something else is deceiving you. They are distracting you. They are deceiving you and distracting you from what really matters. Because at the end of the day, it comes back to the law. The law is what we have to keep in order to have salvation. Isaiah 56. If you read Isaiah 56, it's all about going back to the commandment and keeping Sabbath for salvation. When it comes to having your sins forgiven, It comes back to going back to keeping the law, according to Ezekiel chapter 18. If you happen to watch this online, if you watch this video on YouTube, and you have any question, I am always open. You are more than welcome to give me a call. Give me a call on the number you see on the screen. I'll be more than happy to answer your question regarding this topic. I also have something very special I would like to send to you. If you are watching this video online and you would like to start keeping these laws and the commandment, I will send you like a literature. I will send you something that I put together that will help you to understand the laws and the commandment. Because as you can see from everything we're going through today, we heard from the word of Christ himself. Christ is telling you in Revelation 22:14 that if you're going to have salvation, you must keep the law. You must keep the law if you're going to have salvation. Revelation 22:14. It's always all about keeping the law. It's always about keeping the commandment. That's what it comes down to. Always. As you can see in Revelation 22:14. It's all about keeping the commandment. So if you would like to learn these laws and the commandment that we are required to keep in order to have salvation, if you would like to learn about the laws and the commandment of God, feel free to contact me. You can send me a message and say, brother, send me those laws and the commandment. I will be more than happy to send it to you for free. I will send it to you either on your email or text. However, I will send you a link and you can go to my website and you download those laws and the commandment. And you can go through them and begin to learn them. It's in your Bible. I'm talking about the laws and the commandment in your Bible. I am not talking about our church doctrine. We do not have church doctrine. We simply follow the Bible. I am not talking about you joining our church. I am talking about you following those laws and the commandment in your Bible. I am talking about you as a brother growing your beard. Just like it says in Leviticus 19:27. I am talking about you stopping eating shrimp. No more eating shrimp, because that is unclean, according to Leviticus chapter 11. I am talking about you avoiding lying. I'm talking about you breaking the Sabbath, which, by the way, Saturday is not the Sabbath day. I am talking about you abandoning Christianity, going back to keeping the law. I'm talking about you keeping the Sabbath on the right day. Saturday is not the Sabbath day. Sunday is not the Sabbath day. Sabbath is based on the phases of the moon. These are all the things you will see on that information I'm going to send you. So if you watch this video on YouTube and it touches you in your heart and you need more information and you have questions and you would like to learn more about the laws and the commandment that we have to keep, feel free to contact me. I will send you those information for free. Because at the end of the day, it's all about the law. It's not about faith. It's not about grace. It's not about belief. You can have faith all you want. You can have belief all you want. If you do not obey, you're wasting your time. It comes down to obedience to the laws of God. So all praises to our Heavenly Father. I give the Most High all the glory and all the honor. I thank the Most High for opening our eyes to understand these things. I thank the Most High for opening our eyes to understand the danger and the distraction that this type of teaching that came from the Gentiles have brought to us. Our people today focus on Jesus, 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 Jesus. New Testament, 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 Jesus, New Testament, Jesus. These things are fake. The idea of just focusing on Jesus, 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 Jesus is a big distraction. It's all about the commandment. I have shown you today from the word of God, if you want to have salvation, you have to keep the Sabbath. You have to keep the laws and the commandment. That's Isaiah chapter 56. That is how you get salvation, by keeping the law. Isaiah chapter 56. I have shown you, even Christ said it here in Revelation 22:14. Revelation 22:14. Blessed are those that do his commandment, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gate into the city, the New Jerusalem. It's all about keeping the commandment. That is what we should focus on. This whole new doctrine of focusing on Christ, focusing on Jesus, is demonic. It's a big distraction. and it distracts us from keeping the law that we have to keep in order to have salvation, according to Isaiah chapter 56. It distracts us from keeping the law that we have to keep in order to have our sins forgiven, according to Ezekiel chapter 18. So I thank the Most High for opening our eyes and helping us to understand these things. The ball is now on our court. It's up to us to now go back and keep these laws. If you want to have salvation, we go back and keep these laws. I didn't even mention prosperity. I did not even mention prosperity. As you see in Joshua chapter 1, 7 to 9. Joshua chapter 1, 7 to 9. Joshua chapter 1, 7 to 9. The Most High told Joshua, if you want to become prosperous, if you want to have prosperity, meditate in the book of the law day and night. Meditate in the law day and night. Joshua chapter 1, verse 7 to 9. Joshua chapter 1, verse 7 to 9. And not only that, also Psalm chapter 1, 1 to 3. Psalm chapter 1, 1 to 3. The book of Psalms, chapter 1, verse 1 to 3. We are told to meditate in the book of the law day and night. So at the end of the day, however you look at it, however you think about it, it also always comes down to the law. I didn't even mention Deuteronomy chapter 28, where the Most High clearly spells out his blessing. Deuteronomy 28 is always coming back to the law. Focus on keeping the law. Focus on learning the law. And I will do whatever within my power to help you to learn the law. You will never be by yourself. You'll never be alone. If you happen to go through this and you would like to start keeping God's law, feel free to contact me and I'll be more than happy to send you that information so you can begin to learn these laws and begin to keep these laws and be able to have your sins forgiven and be able to get salvation, which Christ tells us that is through keeping the commandment. So all praises to our Heavenly Father. I give the Most High all the glory and all the honor. Do not hesitate if you watch this online. More than welcome to contact me. I will send you that information. You'll be able to start learning these laws. It's in your Bible, actually. I'm not going to send you something that is not in your Bible. What I'm telling you is in your Bible. It's just a guide that will help you to go through your Bible and find those laws. Like when you look at Leviticus chapter 19. Leviticus chapter 19, you know, Exodus chapter 20, Exodus 22. These are places you're going to see different types of laws. So I am all about focusing on God's law. I'm all about doing whatever I can to help anybody who is interested in keeping God's law. I don't care who you are, whether you are Chinese, you are European, you are African. It doesn't matter who you are. As long as you have interest in obeying God and keeping his law, I will do whatever I can to help you accomplish that goal. The goal that everybody and anybody should have is to keep the laws of God. That is the only way to please God. That is the only way to be accepted on that day. It's all about the law. It is not all about Jesus. It's all about the law. I showed you today from the word of the Most High, you clearly see that it's all about keeping the laws and the commandment. So I thank our Heavenly Father for opening our eyes. I thank the Most High for giving us understanding so that we'll be able to focus properly on doing his will, obeying him, walking carefully, very carefully in keeping his laws and his commandment, which if we do, we will have life. We're suffering today because we're no longer keeping the laws of God. So all praises to our Heavenly Father.
Thank you for your interest in this video. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact us through WhatsApp. You can call us or send us a message. You can also email us at lawstogod@gmail.com. Check out our website at www.lawstogodskingdom.com. Download our mobile app from the Android store. Search for Laws to God app. You can also find us on Facebook. Just search for Laws to God. Don't forget, you can also use Skype to call us. Just download Skype on your phone and search for Laws to God. If you are in South Africa and you need a congregation to worship with, give us a call. For more information that we don't have here on YouTube, please download our app and check out our website, www.lawstogodskingdom.com. Help us spread this truth by sharing this video on your social media.